Prime Minister, thanks for joining SBS.
Thanks, Anna. It's good to be here.
Look, in this budget, you have a $250 payment for those who are struggling the most, but that will probably pay for one bag of groceries and one tank of fuel. So what happens for them after that?
Well, this is why the pension only increased in the last couple of weeks. That's why the pension always increases in line with inflation. And this is why this additional support is being provided. Right throughout the pandemic, we have consistently provided additional support to those on fixed income payments. And I think Australians know that when they're hurting, that our government has always been there to help them through the most difficult of times. So whether you're on those fixed payments as a pension, I mean, pensioners go to the same bowsers that the rest of us do. Fuel excise has been halved. The tax on petrol has been halved for 6 months. And for those who are of working age, they're earning, they're paying taxes. There's an increased tax cut for them on the 1st of July. And this is a responsible and targeted way of dealing with what are very real cost of living increases, and particularly in relation to petrol. And that, as we know, has been caused by the terrible events that we've seen in Ukraine.
$250, as I said, for the lowest income earners, or the people in the economy who need it the most, who aren't on an income. $420, though, for those who are filing a tax return, therefore on a higher income. Why is that? Why don't the people who need it the most get the most money?
Well, they're getting support, $250, and it's been in addition to all the other supports we've provided to those on fixed incomes. Those who are earning, you know, take some, a family, two people, we're earning $90,000 a year. With the expenses that go with a household and a family and the kids and all of these things, those household costs are even higher. And so for those who are working, we're enabling them to keep more of what they earn. That's what we're doing for those who are working. And we're ensuring that Australians can keep more of what they earn to help them get through what is a very difficult time with cost of living increases. And those who are on fixed income through the pension, this is enabling us to provide that additional support on top of the recent increases in the pension that have just come through.
When we look at page 49 of Budget Paper 2, I'm sure you're familiar with every page, there is a measure here which suggests there are $3 billion of cuts that you've made. You've certainly sung the praises of all the spending. What are the details of this $3 billion?
Well, the Labor Party have raised this, and it shows that they don't understand what a budget is and how it works. The way the contingency reserve works in the budget and the decisions taken but not yet announced, which is what you're referring to, is as they're announced and as you draw down from that, then that's what it means when those resources are largely removed. And so that's what happens in a budget. When you bring those decisions forward and you make the changes, the provisions that you've made in the future, you no longer need them. See, this is my fourth budget as a Prime Minister. I did three as a Treasurer, and prior to that, I did 1 year on the Budget Committee. So this is eight budgets now that I've been directly involved in. The Treasurer's, this is his fourth budget. Anthony Albanese, he's never delivered one. And so, that's why Labor doesn't really understand how budgets work.
And
so what they've raised here, in terms of suggesting this is a cut, is just completely false. They don't understand budgets. If they can't work out how a budget works, then how can you trust them to manage one?
And I haven't delivered any budgets, so let's say that up front. But $3 billion, it's got to go somewhere. Is this going into election spending measures? Where is this money going, or where has it gone?
Well, as we continue to make announcements, that means the changes we've made and the provisions that we've made, they become very clear as we go through the weeks that are ahead. But that has already been included in the announcements we've made in the budget.
So to be very clear, is this $3 billion money that you are going to announce in the coming weeks before the election?
No, it's a mixture of things. And as we no longer have to provision for more and more things because we're getting closer to the election, by the time you get to the election and when the pre-election fiscal outlook statement is released, the PFO statement, then what has happened is everything that's been in the provisioning is basically taken out, and everybody can see exactly what's been done. So that'll be very clear once we get into the budget. But I understand that Jim Chalmers, he's never delivered a budget. He helped Wayne Swan deliver a few, and they weren't very good. And Anthony Albanese never delivered a budget. I think he spent 6 weeks on the Expenditure Review Committee. And I can tell you, with the economic circumstances that we're facing, you don't want someone who doesn't know their way around the budget papers.
Terrible floods are hitting the north coast of New South Wales again. What money is in this budget to clearly and helpfully mitigate? The community was asking for essentially a fighting force to be created to specifically deal with emergency relief. They say the SES is just not enough. What are you doing to address those concerns?
Well, there's $6 billion in this budget. The Treasurer specifically made reference to that last night to particularly deal with the costs and the rebuilding works that are related, especially to these flood events and what we see continue to unfold, sadly, in the Northern Rivers again. The trauma of that, it's just hard to contemplate as the levee bank is breached. And the trauma of the experience of several weeks ago being revisited. And so we have delivered $1.3 billion already to 1.4 million Australians. And we will continue providing that support, but not just that. In addition to that, in Northern Rivers specifically, we've already announced $150 million on flood mitigation works, which has been prevented in the past because of decisions at council level and at state level. So we're getting on with that. And so there's provision for funding to do the important works to provide future protection. But the rebuilding work, already we've committed $2.1 billion specifically to New South Wales. And almost half of that is already out the door. We want to see the programs we're joint funding with the state government to be able to flow through. They're managing those payments, and I know they'll be moving as quickly as they can to get those payments to people. But from the Commonwealth's point of view, we're up close to $1 billion that has already been paid in New South Wales to support the victims of those floods. And we've also been doing the same in Queensland. And these payments are necessary because it helps people get back on their feet to do the cleanup. When we are sharing 50% of the costs when it comes to homes that sadly have to be knocked down, we did the same in the bushfires. Those costs are shared 50-50 with the state government.
And do you share the concerns of Shane Stone that perhaps people living in areas that may again be flood affected in the coming hours do need to consider relocating permanently to essentially higher ground?
Well, these floods in the Northern Rivers, and we advise officially that this is a 1-500-year flood event that we had a few weeks ago. Now, I was up in Brisbane a few weeks ago, and I asked, you know, where did this flood come to? It's here. And I said, where was the highest ever flood in Brisbane? And they said, here. And I said, put 2.5 metres on top of that. That's what happened in Lismore. And so, increasingly, the decisions we have to take about our planning laws, our zoning laws, all of these issues must, you know, help Australians make the decisions that are best for them. In the last couple of weeks ago, in Ballina, as a good example, where there was the new planning laws where some of the new housing estates have been built, they were far less affected than some of the more traditional parts of that town. And I think that goes to resilience is not just about flood mitigation and managing the flow of through the river system. It's also about the planning laws. And Anthony Roberts in New South Wales, I think, has made some really strong points on this. They're things, I mean, we don't manage planning laws. We don't set those codes at a state level or a local government level. But those decisions are important. Protect people in the future. But in the Northern Rivers, where they had that 1-in-500-year event, no one could have protected themselves against that. I stood in a dairy farm where they'd done everything right. They built the dairy shed at the level that was above the worst ever flood. And so they've been impacted by something none of them could have contemplated. And that's why our support has been over and above what we've normally done in response to flood events.
Just on the commodities side of things, we're obviously still heavily reliant on China. So why did you knock back a meeting with the Chinese ambassador in the last couple of weeks?
Well, between Australia and China, China is refusing all dialogue between ministers, all political dialogue.
So is that what you want to see? You want to see essentially President Xi come to you for a direct dialogue? You're not interested in
speaking
to a diplomat?
I'd be happy with our trade ministers to be meeting to discuss the economic coercion and sanctions they're putting on Australian products and that we're pursuing through the World Trade Organization. We see this as economic bullying and coercion. We would love to be able to engage with them, minister to minister, but China has refused that. Now, our ambassador in China isn't allowed to go and even speak to ministers, let alone prime ministers, or indeed President Xi. And so why Australia would be applying a different set of rules when we're being coerced and bullied economically, particularly on trade, on our barley, on our crayfish, on our wine. These are very coercive acts. And so if China actually wants to see things improve, then they should drop the coercion.
Just on another international front, I understand that this week we're expecting potentially the Ukrainian president will address our parliament. Is that correct?
Yes, it is. President Zelensky will address the parliament live on Thursday evening at 5:30. and I'm very pleased he's doing that. We issued that invitation. As you know, he's addressed other parliaments around the world, and he's very, very appreciative of the support that has come from Australia. We're a long way from Ukraine, but there are 40,000 Australians of Ukrainian descent, and I've met with them, and met with Stefan Romanov, who's done a terrific job leading the Ukrainian community here in Australia. We've provided additional support to the Ukrainian Association here in Australia, because you can imagine the additional pressures on them. They're volunteers working in their community group, and they're very grateful to the media, the Ukrainian community, and in helping them to get their messages out. And they need more support for that, travel expenses, administrative expenses. But on top of that, they're very appreciative of the fact that already more than 5,000 Ukrainians have been granted visas. Well over 1,000 now have come to Australia. We've provided that humanitarian visa support, which means people can work, access medical support, accommodation support, and have the opportunity to stay if they wish to. But what I've learnt from speaking to European leaders that border on Ukraine is they will come into their countries, particularly Poland, but they want to go home and they want their country to be peaceful. And so we will provide strong support to Ukraine as we have. And I have no doubt that the Ukrainian president will make more requests, and wherever Australia can practically help, we have and we will, and we'll continue to stand with them.
You've been accused of being a bully and an autocrat on the floor of the federal parliament. You called for an inquiry into those allegations in relation to Labor just in the last couple of days. Will you call an independent inquiry to investigate these claims?
Well, our party has that process, and I would encourage Senator Fierravanti-Wells to raise those issues directly as part of that process. So I'm happy for that to be addressed through that and to be held accountable through that process. But I understand that Senator Fierravanti-Wells is disappointed that on the weekend 500 Liberal Party members came to decide who would contest for the Liberal Party in New South Wales. They rightly, in my view, backed strongly Senator Payne and Senator Molan, and Senator Fierravanti-Wells was unsuccessful on this occasion. She's been successful on other occasions and on occasions with my very strong support, as Senator Hughes knows very well.
Are you doing some soul searching about your own behaviour?
No, I mean, I've provided strong support from my team. I mean, I've stood up for people like Susan Lee, for example. And I had to take that all the way to our federal executive to ensure that female cabinet ministers like Susan Lee, who have played such a strong role in our government, are able to continue to serve. And I'm glad I did.
Prime Minister, we thank you for your time.
Thanks very much.